This is the Freedom Feens, broadcasting from Pod Bay 2A, a mile above sea level, at Intergalactic Prairie Studios. We alter your locus ceruleus by warming your synapses with rejuvenative radio waves. This keeps a sin flood of statism out of your brain. Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Is it working? Bill, Ernie, and Boston, is it working?
Philosophically terraforming the Earth, one disobedient servant at a time.
That's right, decibel by decibel.
Okay, this is an interesting episode because it wasn't meant to be. This was supposed to be live with Bill on the weekends, but these cats called me up smoking cigars and drinking whiskey for breakfast in the middle of the night. This is a Liberty Summit of the drunken 50-year-old hipster OG libertarians. I'm over 50, but I'm not drunk and I'm not an OG libertarian. This is like three of the cats that brought me to Liberty. We got Boston Tea Party, we got Ernie Hancock, and we got Bill Buppert. So do you guys want to introduce yourself a little bit?
I think you just did that.
Yeah, we just did.
I think you did.
Let's move on.
Well, who's who so we can put a name to a name, a voice?
Bill Buppert of ZeroGov.com and author of Zero Gov, Limited Government, Unicorns and Other Mythological Creatures. Boston, take it away.
Mythological creatures. Great. Kenneth Royce. That's a W in between the Kenneth and the Royce because there was a British thriller author who's deceased now and spinning in his British grave that I took his name. Also known as Boston Tea Party and
a libertarian god.
Lots of books. So we got to go through a list of all your books. It's like that Star Trek.
We don't have enough time.
I'll link
episode.
Them in the show notes and
qualify it with libertarian god and just leave it as small g god. Can we just like go from there?
Ernie Hancock. Are you there, Ernie Hancock?
I am here. We're in the studio. They're visiting. Woo! This is what happened. You know, Boston and I, we get to see each other every now and then, you know, and he happened to be in the neighborhood. And Bill Buppert and his lovely wife, Lilo came up and us to party. And last night we went partying like we were teenagers, man.
Oh, yeah.
It was, she goes, you'll love it, man. We go to Scottsdale and it's like, you know, our age. Everybody's got their 67 Chevy pickup out in the parking lot and their leather jacket. It was like a prom.
There's Jilfs there. Jerky, I'd like to.
Yeah. Well, that's for most people, the midlife crisis for men is generally to have an affair and buy a sports car. For libertarians, it's to buy more rifles, stay with your wife, and start a podcast or radio show.
Amen, brother. Amen, brother.
Michael, it's here's the deal. It's not a midlife crisis if you were always that guy. Yeah.
I know. This is the one thing I was thinking, Michael, is that, man, are you alphaed up? Yeah, it's Michael right. W. Dean, Bill Buppert, Ernie Hancock, Boston T. Nobody's going to get to talk.
Yeah, you know, man.
The thing is that they were just, it just happened that our stars aligned and we all could just kind of, they come over and totally. We were chilling. Yeah. So they come and as we're sitting here talking, you know, it's, I've known about this Stefan Molyneux DCM,
DMCA. State.
And, you know, so whatever, I don't care. So
Ernie's been drinking.
So I'm just like going, what was up with that? You know, I'm kind of, you know, I've been on some forums and debated Stefan on a lot of stuff. And I know. But the thing is that I'm like, hey, man, I don't even have an opinion. I don't care. And they go, oh, no.
You've got an opinion.
You got no. They're going, you got to watch this video that Michael Dean did. And I watch it. And I go, I call him. I go,
you need to come
on the show. And Ty goes, well, let's just do a show. And I go, right. Okay, we can do
Because Michael Dean in 90 seconds just took 10 years of Molyneux and summed it up.
Yeah, I had some help with that. You're talking about
a few years ago when they had the roast for Molyneux, the rule was nobody gets to say Molyneux cult. So, you know, everybody had to do
that. Well, you know, he's actually said that he would sue anyone that called him a cult. But I think it's an empty threat because I had someone on the show who said that she was a member. I had two people on the show that were members of his inner circle, and one of them called him a cult over and over and over. And I don't think he's going to sue anybody because that would mean a court would be deciding if he's a cult or not. And I don't think he wants a court looking at that.
Regardless of that, having threatened that you would sue if you say I am a cult means you are a cult. It is. And imagine, you don't need the federal courts to go, well, this is a cult, not a cult.
Well,
the
fact you said, my point is that I didn't take the bait. I didn't really, you know, by the time it came my turn to roast and everything, I was just feeling pretty bad. So I'm just going, you know, of course, a lot of his supporters were there. And I'm just, look, man, you don't want anybody speaking for you. And that was kind of my message. I'm done, and be nice about it. But he really has, from my perspective, I was hoping to have you on my show. And I know you're probably done with it.
I can't get up. Well, I'm kind of done with it, but we'll do it today for an intro of this and then go on just to get all three of you on record.
But I know it's your show, but to save me having to talk about it on my show is that I go, what the hell's up? Can I get 90 seconds of what was going on? What's the big deal? And so on.
Paul and I did it. Yeah.
Look, Michael spent 2 weeks covering this in very comprehensive fashion.
In 90 seconds.
Go,
Michael, tell me what's up.
Well, you know, I would like to get on record what all three of you think about it and then move on from it. And I'd love to be on your show, but I can't get up for your show, man. To get up for your show, it means either I stay up an extra 2 hours and I'm stupid, or I have to get up early and I'm stupid.
Slacktivist.
Communist.
No, we're not slacktivists. Here's the thing, man. We all take different shifts of liberty. So now there's 24/7 of live Liberty Media 7 days a week.
That's the tagline, baby.
Hey, yeah, Michael,
take different shifts for liberty.
Michael Dean's got the graveyard shift. Michael Dean's got the graveyard shift.
24-hour guard, baby.
Well, that's 80% of the libertarians.
Ernie, you come on my show at 1 in the morning till 3 in the morning.
Hey, man. Right. I'm all over.
Sober.
Sleep. Only because your wife massages your feet to get you up in the morning.
She's wearing a mask when she's doing it.
She should.
I know. I mean, it seemed kind of manly hands. I thought that might have been Boston.
Boston only sleeps with you on occasion.
Okay, let's do the Molyneux thing and then move on. So Boston Tea Party, Tea Party, who's been a libertarian since, you know, Molyneux was voting for the Labor Party in England, probably. Boston, what do you think of
negativity? I just want everybody to know that.
What do you think, Boston? What do you think of Stefan Molyneux?
You know, I've only met him. I've only had the pleasure of meeting him twice. And, you know, I don't know. Someone's your kind of person or he's not. And, you know, he was not. I respect a lot of his. It's like, you know, praising some authors. I really like your earlier novels, you know, kind of thing. So it's a backhanded compliment. Yeah. I don't know. The more I've heard and found out, it's like, well, really, you know, really. So, you know,
come on, you're holding back, I think.
Well, I'm holding back because
that's because Boston's a gentleman.
Well, I'm holding back out of ignorance. I mean, my two compatriots here in the studio probably, you know, have heard or read much more than I have of holy moly's. Or if you're wise, you have not. Anyway, you know, his whole, you know, you're raised on a, you know, a state farm, you're a caged animal, and, you know, that's brilliant stuff. It's a great metaphor.
For second graders.
Fine. Fine. If he'd stuck with that and just left it alone, cool. But, you know, he had the need to go further and, you know, have effectively what seems to me like this cult-ish following, and, you know, wasn't necessary. And even though, you know, anyone's ego is... You know, if you're honest, your ego is insatiable, because that's what ego is. It's an insatiable thing. But, you know, why do it? Why not have some, you know, perspective about yourself and go, yeah, I mean, I could have been some cult leader a long
time.
I've
seen you at a gun show and nobody knows who you are. But if somebody says this is Boston Tea Party, a little crowd forms around you and people start following you like they want to touch your garments.
If someone else says it,
and
but
you
I'm not,
wanna, and you want to run away.
On, I got to interject here. Here's Boston, Molon Labe, come to free state Wyoming and let's take over a freaking state in the universe.
That's not a gun show. That's different.
I read that book and I moved to Wyoming and then didn't. I don't leave my property.
Yeah, you totally did.
Because my property is libertarian paradise.
Exactly.
Yeah. And once a year, you three get together and we Skype in together and it's called Bavarian Gulch, and it's where the four of us centrally plan liberty behind closed doors.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Because we all know that spontaneous order is centrally planned.
Yeah, yeah. So we didn't get a chime in yet on Stefan Molyneux from Bill Buppert.
That would be me, and to me, the cardinal sin of Holy Moly is the fact that he does not brook discontent.
Right.
And he goes out of his way that anytime there are questions of anything that he holds forth on, to me, that's the cardinal sin of saying that from a critical thinking perspective, you can't question what I say. Because what I discovered
Why would you? Cross-examination.
Cross-examination is the engine of truth. And if we allow ourselves to be questioned, and Boss and I have both been, we've been on the Liberty Trail a while, and we've been finding that question and answer tends to be the time when people will ask us questions or plant a BS flag in front of us and say, you know what, you're wrong. To which I delight, and I think Boston does too, and Ernie does too, in saying, well, this is why we disagree, and this is the fundamental disagreement that we have, and this is the fundamental disagreement for why we think differently than you do. But in that conversation, that's where we come to an evolution of knowledge and epistemology, where we can arrive at a better conclusion due to superior evidence.
It's a honing of the truth.
Absolutely.
If you're
so
open to it.
So that's what I'm not. That's what I'm not down with. That's what I find that is not groovy about Molyneux, is that he tries to quash discontent. He tries to quash questions and tries to quash dissent. And when you do that, that shows you for who you are.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, it's also really square to squash discontent.
It's very square, isn't it? It is very square.
People call Ian Freeman a cult leader all the time. People call Ian Freeman from Free Talk Live and you know, Free Keen, and he's part of the Free State Project. People call him a cult leader all the time, and he laughs it off, man. He's not going to try to like use government guns against somebody. And you know, that was the big issue people said was, well, Molyneux used the government and he's against the government. And that's a point, but I think it's a bigger point that he tried to squash censorship. You know, tried to censor dissent, even if he did it with magic fairy dust and a magic wand. I don't care how he did it, you know.
Michael, sure, I think that's a critical mass. I think that's the primary question here, is that if you seek the DCMA, I think that is a low blow. But if you seek to question dissent of any type to your viewpoints, what you're doing is you're saying that, please don't question what I say, because I have a like quality in determining what can be questioned and what can't.
It's saying that it can't pass the light of day, basically.
Indeed. Right. Yeah. Indeed.
You know, my first experience with Molyneux, I remember it was years ago, and it was Matrix 13, Statism is Dead, or some one of his videos. And it was the...
We're going to hold that. And
just
come.
Stop talking!
Ernie can't stop talking. He talks stop. Over. I'm just going to mute stop Ernie and tell
stop.
Him.
Stop. See, I got his...
You and the hamster in your brain are listening to Freedom Feens with Michael Dean and his weird friends.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Anti-war, pro-free market. That's antiwar.com. Yeah. Freedom Feens. All liberty, all the time. And the Liberty Summit, the Bavarian Gulch that meets once a year, with Ernie Hancock, Boston Tea Party, and Bill Buppert. Are you there, guys? Yeah.
Meow.
Good to be back.
Yeah. So we just took a little break, and they had some more whiskey for breakfast and smoked some more cigars, and they watched the 7-minute Colbert Report.
I'll never get that 7 minutes back.
Yeah, man. So Boston doesn't know who Chris Cantwell is. He was just introduced to the glory of Chris Cantwell. And so here's the thing.
I'm still reeling.
This guy.
On the hairstyle.
Hang on. That was filmed a month ago, approximately, maybe 2 months ago. And they spent about 2 months finding the best way to edit it to make them look like idiots, and aired it 3 or 4 nights ago. Well, when this is airing, it'll be a week ago.
I think they did a superlative job.
Yeah, it's funny.
Yeah. Yeah. This was a soft
especially
pitch.
The bow. The bow really got me.
Yeah, they
had me at the arrow.
Yeah, they had you at the arrow. So here's the thing Boston doesn't know. Yeah. This is his fault.
Good. I have one.
Here's why. Okay. You know who Larken Rose is, right?
But I have one.
Larken rocks.
Yeah, Larken. So Larken, well, I like his old stuff. How's that?
I just said this.
Come on now, let's not be cruel.
It's Larken, funny. I said
Larken is probably one of the best expositors.
I really like
there.
Your earlier novels.
I mean, his earlier stuff. So, but I actually, when I introduced you to Larken, and I did Boston, I sat you down at a computer and showed you his site. You looked at his tax method, the 861, and you're like, he's doing it wrong.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm from 1989 to 1992. I'm grandpa after Irwin Schiff on this. So
you wrote a book on this.
And I wrote my first book on that. So, you know, I've got my perspective from a long ago.
Well, we can all agree, at least we like Larken's old stuff. And so Larken is vastly influenced by Boston Tea Party. You know, some of his edgier stuff about maybe the non-aggression principle could include preemptive whatever, you know, like kind of Molon Labe type essays about, you know, Molon Labe inspired essays. So Larken wrote a piece at one point called "When Is It Okay to Shoot a Cop?" which was just a thought experiment of basically, if you believe in the Second Amendment.
And worthy of exploration, of course.
Yeah. So Chris Cantwell became friends with Larken, saw the attention Larken was getting, and said, I can do better than this, and went on this whole tirade of writing essays about maybe it's time to start shooting cops. And he kind of took, like, you know, Larken's kind of gentlemanly take on the very gentlemanly take of Boston stuff. And by third generation, it turned into the frat boyness that is Cantwell today.
Right. Which he's backtracked from.
I'm a big supporter of Larken. We work on a lot of things, so I'm not going to say anything bad about Larken. But I tell you, is when to shoot a cop. We have a new newspaper coming out, and it's, you know, going to be great, wonderful, of course. But the point is that do I or do I not put in the article when to shoot a cop? I mean, just even to have that headline.
Yeah,
and I'm like,
And,
you know, it may be a link to, you know, what, because the thing was, is when they had the Occupy Phoenix thing here, the black Chris with the AR-15 that went to a bombing, you know, big deal that was going on, he printed out a crap load of those and was passing them out. So the local fusion center freaked out.
You think?
All it did was bring attention to this article that was awesome. Because, well, I'm going, well, obviously they didn't read it because they don't want to bring attention to this. Because the argument that Larken made was basically this. You know, it's probably, I don't know exactly when before, but it's sometime before the door on the cattle car closes.
Well,
this is the same argument that Claire Wolfe makes, by the way.
Yeah, and she did she influence you, Boston? Was she writing before you?
No,
she was a big influence on us.
Yeah, well, Claire wasn't writing her great works before me. But however, she encapsulated something that I was, you know, brewing about. You know, it's too early to shoot the bastards, but it's too late to work within the system. I never saw a better metaphor.
Yeah, and that was 15 years ago.
Which it was my metaphor, right?
Yeah.
And, okay, you're saying it's 15 minutes ago.
I'm not saying it's time. I'm just saying 15 years ago that statement rang true. I think it still rings true. But
yeah, but that's the point. We're still not, you know, beyond a historical point where she's passé. Then I wish I thought of that way of putting it, and we're still there. So I wouldn't say she influenced me, cause I was trying to say effectively the same thing. And I guess I still am. And, when that point is for individual. However, I think when it's sort of like really obviously that's the point, you know, we'll all know, you know, kind of thing. But, I don't think we're talking yet.
I know when we'll know. It's when you go to the village square and you're not the only one there.
Hey, you're
there.
Not supposed to be talking with the music.
So can you shut up,
Ernie?
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
Freedom Fiends. It's the Liberty Summit that didn't cost anything. You just get to Skype in later, a week later. So, you cats there?
What is the experience?
Yeah, we're here.
Yeah.
He's
all
already right. Got 2 minutes.
So, yeah.
Okay, well, Ernie, I want to ask you something real quick, though. I mean, I hear the commercial that you do for Rats by Clara Wolfe. Clara Wolfe was a big influence on us as young activists indeed. In the 90s. And she spoke at one of our Freedom Summits. She's all, you know, kind of like Boston, you know, was, you know, this clandestine wear a hat, don't take my picture kind of thing. And
he's always been that way.
But, you know, so Claire has been awesome. And her publisher really, you know, how did you get her to come on your show? She'll come on every now and then. They really wish she'd do more to pump her books. But when she did 101 Things to Do Until the Revolution, she had a couple of segments in there on different groups that we had done. And we just started using the internet. And she had, you know, we're at that, you know, kind of that, you know, strange time in America where it's too late to, it's too late to work within the system, but too early to start shooting the bastards. Right. And it may be too early, but you know, we're a day
closer. He said bastards.
Well, we're,
that could be 20 years.
We're a day closer. Okay. We're a day closer. So it's, I'm just going, I'm trying to avoid that part, but you had a commercial that you did on rats. And tell me how you came across that and why you did that and the support of that. I mean, tell me about that.
I actually did that because I did an episode of the Freedom Fiends with Davy Barker called "Is Chris Cantwell a Cop?" I don't really think he's a cop. And Davy and I have also come up with a new corollary to Goodwin's Law, which is, you know, instead of you lose the argument as soon as you compare your opponent to Hitler, it's you lose the argument as soon as you suggest the other guy's a cop or a government agent, because all of us have been accused of being government agents. Would you say that's true? I have.
Not for me. No.
That's true.
I'm too early.
Except for Boston. That's true. Oh,
well, Boston isn't on the internet, so he doesn't know that he has been accused of being a government agent.
Well, that's because the internet is a new kind of technology for Boston.
Now, is that
where the slaves can all talk to
the interwebs?
Okay, so here's the thing. I don't think Campbell's a cop.
No,
but I think if you look at his overall everything, he might be more useful to the government than any government PSA.
Confidential informant.
You know,
your friend Mark Stevens has accused me or has suggested I sound like a COINTELPRO agent. Now, here's the thing. That book, Rats, I'm still answering Ernie's question from before the break. Ernie, that book, Rats, the reason that I did ads for the book Rats was I was looking at, you know, like people like Cantwell and Larken saying, well, we should be asking the questions. I'm not saying you should shoot a cop. You know, they always have these dog whistle like that sound basically like it's time to shoot cops, but they're not willing to do it. And Chris Cantwell can barely hold a gun. So he's not any guy to lead a revolution. I'll say that. But the book Rats is like 50 pages long. It's a short book. It's on identifying government, you know, people who are trying to join it, either snitch, get you to snitch or spy on you or get you to do violent things. Every page or every other page of that 50 page book and all the different lists it have of how to spot government agents. The main one that comes up over and over and over is coming into a peaceful movement and calling for violence. And Chris Cantwell has come into a peaceful movement and started calling for violence in a really frat boy way. My biggest problems with him aren't the questions he's asking. It's how he asks them and the fact that he's really into negative publicity. He doesn't, he's got kind of like a man child attitude about it. He thinks I'm jealous that he has more, and I actually have a bigger audience than him because I'm on radio and he's not, but he has a bigger blog presence. And he really thinks that like any attention is good no matter what. And I don't,
he measures his success by how much traffic he.
Literally.
May I also suggest that what it comes down to is that, am I making revolution actionable in a fashion that the United States government would like? And what you'll find most terrorist incidents in the U.S. is that they, you know, the FBI or whatever the other government agency is that's involved in it, they're the ones who are usually there in the audience saying, hey,
yeah,
to plant dynamite.
We need to move on.
We need to start violence.
Yeah, this is a Dead Kennedys line about that.
Time for talk is over, just like Boston said.
There's a Dead Kennedy song from 1979 called Riot that has the line, you know, I'll slip on my wig and see if I can start a riot. I'll go into your group.
You know, we went through this here in Arizona. We've been doing this a long time. Yeah, it was a Viper militia thing. A friend of mine did 5.5 years in federal penitentiary for conspiring to teach.
For stupidity.
And yeah, no, that too.
Let's be honest.
Because we go to these guys, we go, you guys are so infiltrated. When we said that one time, they were at a gun show and they're doing all that, because they used to have, I swear, they had a newsletter called SHF, and it stood for Suicidal Hippie. Okay.
Oh my God.
And it was all the
Can
stuff.
Can you say that on the air with the FCC?
We're beeping everything. I'm going through this with a fine tooth beep.
Michael, take care of that.
I will.
So what happened was is that they had two agencies that were infiltrated them, and I think the two agencies didn't know for a while that they were both infiltrating.
That's
so
hilarious.
They were escalating. We should do more than that. No. So it's the two agents that were kind of escalating this up, and nobody would. They didn't. The militia guys that were training, whatever, they didn't care about that. They weren't looking for that. Right. And so it was all manufactured, and that even came out. Ted Koppel and Nightline goes, hey, man, this isn't really what they were saying it was. So it was just all a game. But, you know, some of the guys did time. I saw it, and I see it subsequently. I've been around a long time in different, you know, workshops that we've had. We had 5 different, you know, Freedom's Phoenix style workshops since 94. And what happens is there's always that guy that shows up first, leaves last, and he wants to help you with your database.
Yeah, and guess what? He's photographing license plates in the parking lot.
Gone through this, we know. So
here's why I like the old guard better than the new guard. And there are people in the new guard that are doing it right, but they aren't the people that jump in front of a camera like a deer in front of the headlights of a car. No. Now, here's the thing. Okay, Chris Cantwell jumps at the opportunity to go on national TV, knowing he'll be made to look like an idiot, and waves his snubby nose revolver at, you know, his little girly gun at the
that's cool.
Yeah, he thinks that's cool. He sweeps downtown Keene himself and the cameraman. Boston Tea Party gives a gun training class. Well, let's not even say that. Boston Tea Party is out using a rifle. I'm filming it. He's showing like incredibly accurate and precise 700 yard riflemanship techniques. Mm-hmm. He has me send him the video and then tells me not to post it.
I'm not on my best day because, you know.
Boston, I want your opinion on the gun handling in that.
Well, you know, gun handling has to be perfect. You're perfect. You can't have, I had a 99% day.
It's a battle drill.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you're wielding deadly force out of your muzzle is, you know, emanating, you know, deadly energy, you know, 24/7, and you've got to do it perfectly.
Which, taking training from Boston, he's like, you know, I got
Ernie's trying, Ernie's getting there.
I got gun stocks to the face, you know.
Yeah, and Bill Buppert.
Yeah, damn right.
Bill Buppert has trained soldiers in the military. Whatever you think about the military, they do gun training right. Bill, what would happen to a private who did what Cantwell did to his CO?
For a sec, the reason why the military has done it right is because of the civilian side from the 70s and Jeff Cooper and all the acolytes thereof. Would that be fair?
I think that's fair, and there's no such thing, for instance, as an accidental discharge. It's always an negligent discharge, means that whatever your gun handling skills are, whatever happens when a muzzle is pointed at you, that is the first rule of gunfighting, which unless you have your muzzle pointed at somebody you're willing to kill, you are wrong if you're doing it.
So
Bill, I called in Free Talk Live and to talk about this video you guys just saw, and I don't have any problems with, I don't think this is setting liberty back hundreds of years. I think it's funny and it's stupid and it's Colbert. But the gun handling thing really bugged me, and it seemed to bug nobody else in Liberty, which bugged me because it should.
With Cantwell, you mean?
Yeah, with Cantwell. And, you know, one of the guys on Free Talk Live, Johnson, who's not really a gun guy, he's fired one a few times, was like, oh, it wasn't that big. He was, you know, it was barely, he did, but yeah, it was holstered. What do you think of that?
As much as I hate zero tolerance, when it comes to the battle drills and the inculcation of skills that Boston and I and Ernie would emphasize when it comes to gun handling, you are responsible not only on your gun handling, but your reputation. If just one time you handle your gun in an irresponsible or, I would say, unliberty fashion, you're putting the whole liberty movement at risk by doing that very thing. Because yeah, what you're saying
that.
Is,
nah, you're it saying goes that deeper than that.
So, Ernie, the non-gun guy, is the one saying it's not that big of a deal.
Hey, let me chime in here, Michael.
I'm gun.
He's not. He's not a gun.
He's not a non-gun guy
because I've taught Ernie at our Appleseed projects when I was formerly an Appleseed shoot boss, and Ernie does demonstrate the proper skill sets. And there are five basic rules, among which the first rule is that when you take your gun out of the holster or you're deploying an AR-15, you're doing it in a fashion in which if you depress that trigger, you're going to put somebody in the hazard. And Ernie knows better than most that if you do that, that's the wrong thing to do. That's why I emphasize that negligent discharge is just an excuse. It's all about accidental discharge. Mm. Your ability to manipulate that trigger is the sine qua non of your ability to determine what the destiny of that round is that's in the weapon.
Yeah. Of which responsible every time the trigger is depressed.
I think that skill with guns is secondary to safety with guns. I would much rather go shooting with somebody who at their best shot can hit a foot square target at, you know, 20 yards, who has completely perfect gun safety, than go shooting with a guy who can hit a fly at 400 yards.
But who's an unsafe.
Who's muzzle sweeping people.
Yeah, yes. I totally agreed. Safety comes first. Just okay, paramount.
This is the
and
point.
And I am the guy that can hit the 1 foot square thing at 20 yards only every time, but I'm totally safe with guns.
This is the point that I wanted to make. I was really glad that you guys
did the
Guns and Weed movie, because it really had a lot of good demonstrative gun safety in there and kind of what the principle was. My thing is that, you know, these guys will tell you, I mean, you know, I got my share. I'm okay. And they go, ooh, another gun's here now. Ooh, look over here. Look at what, man, is there any place anywhere the grandkids can't reach? That's where the guns
well,
are.
Well, have you seen our follow-up gun training with the non-aggression principle with Jared Waltz, volume 1?
I have.
Yeah, Jared is a Free State Wyoming guy. I've shot with him on ranges. Jared is a pretty tightened up
sounds
guy
like
for that.
A
yeah.
link
yeah.
that you be sending me. To
you know
on?
How that actually started was I shot a little video of Herc at the Free State Wyoming Jamboree.
Herc's the best.
It's
quite a good shooter.
We did a video that's like a minute long. It's called How to Shoot a Glock Faster and More Accurately. It has a third of a million views on my YouTube, more than any other thing I've ever done. And I was like, hey, let's make a series out of this. And Herc and I started talking, and we were like, we just kind of butted heads too much. And then he was like, why don't you do it with Jared instead?
Yeah, you two guys are different.
We'll be right back. On the Freedom Feens.
You're listening to the Freedom Feens, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
Do you believe in free speech? Jay Raven had her True Shives YouTube channel taken down. We believe this censorship was wrong, and we believe the channel is a clear example of free speech. Many people are bullied on the internet, but Jay Raven actually stood up to the bullying. She has filed a self-defense lawsuit against the individuals who took down the channel. The outcome of this suit could be very important to the future of free speech. Learn more at trueshives.com. That's Tango, Romeo, Uniform, Sierra, Hotel, India, Bravo, Echo, Sierra.com. Trueshives.com.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach and donate most of our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Fiends. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
Michael Dean, Freedom Fiend. This is the last segment of Hour 1, and I'm going to libertarianly volunteer these guys to come back for Hour 2. I've just drafted them into the Liberty Army, the Liberty Mental Militia of the Freedom Fiends. And this segment, five-minute segment, is going to be all Ernie all the time. Go, Ernie, go, 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 go.
You know, the one thing that I did want to bring up is that When you take firearms and you go on the Daily Show of all places or Colbert or whatever, you know, I'm just going, this is, you know what they're going to do. And I wouldn't help, but I know they're just going to keep hammering until they get what they want.
Well, they pick the biggest pogues they could
find. Yeah, they always do that. And when we had the black man with the AR-15, when Obama came to Arizona, all that kind of stuff became a big deal.
Yeah, in my show.
And I told the guys, I said,
and they edited him to look white. They edited out his hands and his face.
All going typical. But what would happen, though, is that I just stayed. If you're not going to do live broadcast, you know, I don't trust you guys. So I'm good. Yeah, right. Everybody and the grandma wanted to talk. Well, then Chris, the young black man that did this, I know he's one of the revolutionaries and so on. He goes on local television. He goes down to the Freedom Phoenix studio. We had a nice video studio there. He thinks he's doing me a favor. And he does 20 minutes of blah, 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 all this great stuff. And there was one line in here and there, and he goes, and I hate Obama, and I hate Obama, and I hate Obama. And they just looped it. You know, they just want to, like, oh, that's what we needed. And he goes, yeah, but I said all this great stuff. And I go,
yeah, but he hates Obama.
Yeah, I go, yeah, right. They'll air that, you know. And I go, fine. So I go, CNN wanted to do a live. So I went on and I did the live thing, and, you know, CNN or Sanka, you'll see it. But the point is that you know that they're going to try and depict you badly. National Geographic called. They wanted to do a series that would include, like, Adam Kokesh doing radio, myself, and everything.
Oh, that's easy.
Kind of trap. And I recorded it. 40 minutes of, hell no, I'm not working with you guys because you're scumbags, okay? And the thing was is that because I know, I go, my job and, like, Michael's job and all of our job is to make fun of when you guys do this kind of stuff. Yeah. Now, of course, Chris made it easy for him and these whatever, you know.
You talking about Chris Cantwell or Chris, black guy with the AR?
No, Cantwell. Cantwell. Okay. No, Chris, the black Chris, he did really good job. Yeah. He was very good about it because he did the TSA.
He wore a suit too.
Later, he went down and stood at the entrance to the TSA line at the airport, passing out stuff, wearing a .45 on his hip. That was awesome. Yeah. So this and that. Now we have a doctor, Barrow's Neurological, famous brain institute here, one of the research scientists. He went down with an AR-15 here recently, and they just announced that they're not charging him. In fact, yesterday he just did a radio show with Mark Victor on another show. He was on mine, and then did another one, and he's not done. He wants to. I'm like, man. You got to, you know, he's more like a Chris kind of a little bit. He's looking to, you know, egg it on. I'm like, we're trying to keep him, you know, where he's safe. But my point is that, you know, trying to make these points with a hostile media like this and then actually putting your hand on the handle of a gun. I mean, actually pulling a gun, actually using a gun, actually displaying a gun is a bad freaking idea. They're just going to do everything they can to, and then of course he's getting criticism from our side of, you know, not safe handling, but it didn't matter. They're going to do, make them look stupid, and we don't need to, you know, help them, you know? So that's why my biggest criticism was, you know, I do like this. I counsel a lot of the young activists. I go, you have the microphone off, then you turn it on, you go, statement one, statement two, statement three, turn it off, step to the side. They go, oh, we got a follow-up. I know. But we're not going to air if we don't. I know. Because they want to do what they want to do. I get, you pick one of the three, and if you're using those, you, and I'm done.
All three are good.
I do that all the time, and we always get what we want.
Because the worst of the three are better than whatever they would have.
You know? Yeah.
So I'll say, you can't say that. It's FCC.
Well, you know, they say without the government, who would point guns at you? Chris Cantwell.
And he's right. But you know, he's not thing, right everywhere across the board because, you know, he has no, like, flair. He doesn't have, like, balance.
You know, I just saw Carla Garrick at Libertarian.
Is that Boston talking about balance?
Yeah. I mean, I could have not had balance from the get-go 22 years ago.
It's easier and more fun to not have balance.
Back.
Well, I wanted to finish my thought on this point. I had Carla. Talked to Carla. Yeah, I got a button.
Ernie's on 4 hours a day, 365.
You know, here five it is. Hours see, watch today. This. Boom,
Boston
done.
Does one interview a year, and it's on the Freedom Feed.
Carla Garrick, I had her at Libertopia, and her turn, she, I know these guys, I turned them off. So there, Carla, when the Free State Project kind of excommunicated Chris, that was a very controversial thing, but they really thought that they had to. And this kind of, do you think in your mind, what would you think about when they kind of excommunicated Chris? Did you think that was justified? Or
I thought it was good. It was in Libertarian. You can do whatever you want on private property. And we'll be back with hour two of the Freedom Feens of the Libertarian Summit of Ernie Hancock, Boston Tea Party, Bill Buppert and Michael W. Dean. After this trip to the free market and then some local and national news that's going to scare the heck out of you, then we'll come back and give you some redemption in the third act. Worms.
Having outgrown childish libertarian fantasies, I now believe in worms! What is Libertarians Against Humanity? It's the only unofficial Cards Against Humanity expansion pack by libertarians, for libertarians, and against libertarians. Libertarians Against Humanity is free to play online, or join the Indiegogo campaign to get physical copies and other perks to play with friends or status you haven't defooed yet. Because if we don't laugh, the status win.
Not recommended for faint heart, thin skins, or those who easily rustle jimmies. Consult a physician if you experience dropping blood pressure or laughter lasts longer than 4 hours.
That's libertariansagainsthumanity.com.
Hey, there's some Squiscar Squiggles from Death Clocks, and you are listening to the Freedoms Fiends on the, you know, the radios. And I guess I says worms now, so there you go.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Feens now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed, buy sheep for sheep on sheep, and two designs for the Freedom Feens. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists. It's only $10 for 5 buttons, including shipping. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network. A collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
This is the Freedom Feeds, broadcasting from the Libertarian Reindoctrination Center's low orbit ion cannon, high atop Financial Beast Plaza on the artificial satellite LibBear 2017, in the intergalactic prairie studios of the Alpha Centauri region. And today we're having our annual Liberty Summit. I think we should make an annual thing out of this.
Annual.
With Ernie Hancock, Boston Tea Party, and Bill Buppert. And I'm not going to give the bona fides of saying that Bill Buppert was a you should listen to him because he was in the army. He was an officer.
Stop.
Right. Bona fides. Well,
yes. So,
well,
Boston, what's your website?
JavelinPress.com.
Okay. And you are the founder or the co-founder of Free State Wyoming?
If there's a co-founder, I've never met him.
I always thought it was Paul Bonneau.
Paul was a very early, co-conspirator and so forth.
He helped do the, you're the founder. He helped do some of the actuary work of figuring out what was the best state in which counties and things, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're talking about work. That's a whole different thing other than Boston.
Ernie does know about that. You know, work.
Ernie and I have been friends for 20 years, and Boston has been a signature influence on my thinking, especially when it comes to the Constitution, with his book, The Hologram of Liberty, which talks about why the Constitution is probably one of the most clever slave documents ever crafted to make a free people.
One of the things I'm really good at, which you guys pointed out, is summing up a book length thing in 15 seconds.
Yes, you are.
Summed up Hologram of Liberty in 5 seconds of an ad that the Freedom Fiends have played in every show for our buttons. It's a takeoff on an ad that used to be on LRN for like some Ron Paul for Liberty thing that said, it's for Liberty stickers. They used to have this ad that says,
this is a really long 5 seconds.
It says, that said, like, you've attended lectures, you've read books, you know well enough to know that there's still one thing missing, and it's buttons. And I paraphrased that and I said, you've attended lectures, you've read books, you've studied the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal government, but there's still one thing missing. Freedom Fiends buttons. And that 5 seconds in there, that 5 seconds sums up your book.
Sell the Hologram of Liberties, did it work? I mean, you just sucked that right up, dude.
By the way, I want to do an unpaid advertisement for Boston.
I'll have to pay somewhere.
He, in 2012, did a complete... revision of Hologram of Liberty, and I highly recommend it to all
after 15
the
years.
Audience.
After 15 years.
How did I not know this? We should do a show on just Hologram of Liberty.
You didn't know that,
Bernie,
because
that
you're
yet.
Not a reader. That's Ooh, why.
He's not a reader.
You know, I'm a new age reader. I'm like, you know, if it's not on the internet in the form of an email that's no more than 250 you know, words, I
have a proposal.
And 30 seconds attention span.
Boston and I are 19th century men trapped in the 21st century.
Yes,
we read.
Grateful for repeating firearms and, you know, aircraft.
Bill and I rehooked up. In 1994, he had come up here when I was doing something. And, you know, we kind of briefly, you know, what's up?
Libertarian stuff.
But it was when I took an apple seed thing. And he goes, wow, you're Ernie, a lot fatter. But then I've trimmed down since then. But the thing is that, you know, the Appleseed thing was way more history than I anticipated.
Right.
It was like, you need to have these
it
skills.
It was also kind of like Constitution licking a lot, too, which
but
kind
Bill
of
did the yards. History with alacrity.
Yeah, no. It was awesome.
That's right.
You know what we did is we had a big thing with Freedom's Phoenix. We had a lot of couples came because women and children were free. You know, so we went in Boston, you know, I mean, Bill had, you know, the training there and it was a 2-day deal and the women got it was a really good time. I really enjoyed that.
Yay. You know, I have a suggestion, and this is not I'm not contracting this on air saying I'll do it, but maybe we should talk about this. Volume one of Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Jared Waltz, has been out for about 2 years, and people from time to time say, where's volume two? Maybe volume two and three should be Bill and Boston.
I
agree.
You know, you'll have to talk to Jared about that. You know, I don't know what he's got planned.
Well, here's the thing. Jared could do
is
one.
He's a good, accomplished tactical shooter. I've shot with Jared.
Okay, so Boston's saying no, but maybe Bill could be number three.
I'm not saying no. I'm saying no as far as a work product, just because he has his deal. Yeah. I've got mine. I'm saying yay to Jared because...
He said he has enough knowledge to do a volume two, but not beyond that. So maybe I'll do volume two with him and I'll do volume three with Bill.
You know, if he says that's actually, you know, accurate and
that's
modest.
That's what he said. Yep.
Right. He's like, I can get you to here, but not, you know, the next floor.
Look,
kind of
Boston
thing.
And I are in the same hero worship society of our respective gun skills. There's no doubt about that. I know that Boston knows his way around a gun and knows
and
what he's
versa.
About.
Right.
And I know the same.
Yeah, where we learn it from.
Exactly. Yeah, what we learned it from
Clint
is the fundamentals.
Smith, Jeff Cooper. You know,
Jeff Cooper,
exactly.
All the rest of them, even though I don't adopt.
You know, for all
choice,
you gunnies out there to know so that you don't get yelled at by Boston, this is the one thing. I always held my muzzle down facing the ground.
So
Boston will kick your ass. If
no, you
yell.
You held it up. This is what I bust your ass for. You held your rifle up and you walk to the range and then sweep it down.
Now, hurry up. Me for holding it down.
Now I have to tell you
because
that.
you got it wrong in some inverse dream kind of thing.
Boston
would have been great.
Boston and I would have a contempt here because
Ernie, stop talking.
Bill, you weren't there. He's talking about something in another state. He was in a class.
Was Ernie doing something wrong?
Yeah. He'd like cart the thing muzzle up and then sweep it down.
Oh, like Miami Vice.
Here's how I look at it and how I learned at it. And this is a really useful thing is to look at.
Ernie can't even remember how he held the gun.
Okay.
Ernie, you're such a loser when it comes to gun safety.
It's really easy. You just pretend that the gun is always blasting a laser, destroying everything in its path.
That's my metaphor.
Thank you.
Exactly.
Thank you.
That's yours. I got it from you. That's
coming out of the
I try to be very conscientious, but it's always good to have Boston around.
Ernie,
to make
Ernie
sure
tries hard.
Very conscientious.
Not Sul, which is Portuguese for south, which means you're pointing the gun primarily at the ground, but you want to have the gun pointed primarily in front of you, following where your eyes are.
Yeah.
That's the way you want to present it at all times. Until you hear the call.
Oh, you can giggle.
Holster
you can
safe.
Giggle deep.
What you should? You're saying you should walk around with a gun pointed straight in front of you?
No, he
as
says,
long as
he
you
says
know
slightly,
what's behind it.
Slightly in front of you.
As long as you know what's
okay.
behind it. Yes, right. Indeed.
Oh, I remember what it was. I go like this. I said, I was holding it up because I remember there was some movie when I was a kid
now
that I watched.
Remember.
Don Johnson.
They said, don't hold it down because you might shoot your hunting dog. That's what it was. So I'm holding it.
No, it's in the Outlaw Josie Wales. I saw it today.
Was that what it
is? But you were aiming at a god.
Yeah, I was shooting. Yeah, whatever. So I'm shooting at me. You put it down. I go, but I killed my dog.
Yeah, he said that. And I was like, I've never heard that before.
I remember.
That's the weirdest thing I've ever heard.
Kill the dog. I remember.
And really, when you hear the term. All you new
gun owners. Kill the dog.
When you hear the phrase weirder than others, then you'll know what Ernie's done.
It was psychological expiation. I've never heard that out of dozens of classes I've taught. He's like,
okay, so
Filatini's.
All right.
I just want everybody to know that while I do practice great gun safety, Boston provides me the proviso on which how the right way is done. If Boston does it, usually I'll emulate what he does.
Yeah.
That's very kind. I try to, you know.
I emulate what Boston does so he doesn't kill me.
No, you don't.
Send Ernie out for coffee.
Liam Neeson from Taken says, I have a very exotic set of skills and you don't want to be the recipient.
That's true.
Thereof, of those skills. And that's what it comes down to.
Look, you know, if I see someone who is 80% there, you know, in safety and tactical deployment, it's like, cool, we're on the same page.
Because perfect is the enemy of the good, Boston.
Well, no. Perfect is the friend of the perfect. I mean, let's just...
You know what we
should
do?
Perfect is a friend of the perfect only when the perfect is done.
We need to go up to the shooting range tomorrow and see who's
ahead. I think he should go right now as soon as we're done.
I want to know who's the freaking man.
I'm here to tell you that Boston and I, both carrying handguns,
we'll go during this broadcast
as we speak, despite what apparently is... Our slight inebriation, or whatever the case may be,
would apparently be.
Are perfectly safe.
Yeah, I feel
with
safe.
Our firearms.
Well, okay,
in the studio.
No, Bill's very soon. All right, let me qualify something Bill just said. He said, I don't know what you said, but
yes, you do.
He was talking.
What I'm going to say is, you know, it's an adjunct to the, you know, perfect practice makes, it's like, no, practice make perfect. No. Practice does not
because
make perfect.
Smooth is fast, Boston.
Yeah, well, I'm going to get there, but the misnomer phrase is, practice makes perfect. No, practice will make whatever you practiced perfect. Right?
If you do it wrong, it'll make you wrong perfect.
You're going to make perfect. So perfect is.
You can't say so for FCC.
No, there was one guy that was at the training with
that was
Boston.
A Portuguese phrase.
We were up at a friend's farm.
I didn't mean that.
Hey, Ernie, stop talking.
We were at a friend's farm up there, and there was a gentleman that his name was Ruben, and slow is smooth.
Hello, Michael.
Is
can
fast.
You hear me?
Yeah. Ernie's talking. I think the name of this episode should be Hey, Ernie, Stop Talking.
I took that on.
Yeah, you know, but that's secondary, and you've moved
no,
on.
No,
why
no,
are you
no. This
your
is
hands
what he,
up
I wanted
like
to
that.
Say this.
Ernie,
one
don't
point.
Hold your
I
hands went, up. You know, like here, that. Ernie.
And I have the button. So what happened was, is he goes like this. He said he loves shooting because he does a lot of brain stuff, alpha, and biofeedback. And he said, I love shooting because it provides immediate biofeedback. And I've always looked at it as a brain thing since then. And I go out and I really try and do well because it's a biofeedback thing. And just practicing that art of shooting is really effective in a lot of other ways, too.
Yeah, I can see that.
See, I got the button.
Okay. You got the button.
That's
because you shut the buttons off to shut us out. That's why.
Skippy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Why would you shut Boston and Bill Buppert out? Because we are the authorities
because
in the
I
on gunfighting.
Okay, slip Ernie a Mickey and we'll do the rest of the show then.
We don't have a large
Ernie
enough glass for
Mickey
that
to
Mickey.
Make him shut his
Michael,
cake
I'm
hole.
Sorry. Yeah.
That's right. So
is that Billatini thing?
So we're about to go to a break here, but when we come back, what I want to talk about is going forth, as OG libertarians, and I don't want to ask Ernie about this because Ernie has answered this question.
Don't ask Ernie anything.
No, Ernie has answered this question for many hours on every show, and Boston does about one interview every 2 years, and Bill's on the radio all the time now, so I mainly want to ask Boston, but I want to ask both of you what you think of where the liberty movement has gone since you started in it.
I have thought.
You're listening listening to Freedom Feens. So much truth, it hurts. Creamy Radio Audio. Want caviar sound on a cat food budget? Creamy Radio Audio by the Freedom Feens has great free tips so you can sound like a pro without spending like one. The most powerful form of human communication is one person speaking to another. But if people have to suffer through your sound, they'll change the channel and miss your message. With articles on microphones, preamps, recorders, mastering, recording remotely over the internet, doing a podcast, even getting a show on actual radio, the Freedom Feens show you what they use and where to get it. Whether you're a talk show host, voiceover artist, podcaster, evangelist, or just want to record your loved ones for the ages, at Creamy Radio Audio, the Freedom Feens will help you make the most of your sound. Creamy Radio Audio will help you speak to the world with sound that will make people want to keep listening. Check out creamyradioaudio.com. That's creamyradioaudio.com.
Freedom Feens, this is Mike Dean. I'm talking to Bill Buppert and Boston Tea Party, a.k.a. Kenneth Royce. And Ernie Hancock has been sent to the store for more Bill Teenies. So Boston and Bill, and in particular Boston, because I have great respect for both of you guys, but Boston doesn't talk much on the radio. Bill's on my show like once a week. So Boston...
Because
Boston, step, where is Boston?
Okay.
Hold on. Michael, I apologize, but Boston stepped out.
All right, I'll ask you.
I just wanted to say, though, that Michael Dean is probably the preeminent administrator of how to do radio right. He's taught me how to use mics, how to do all the stuff, how to do the radio shows properly, all that stuff. So kudos.
Thank you, man. Ernie has a guy for that.
Ernie is a guy.
Yeah, Michael, you need to help me with my microphone. I got to get a better mic kind of feed.
5 hours today on the Ernie Hancock Freedoms Phoenix.
Yeah, and he talks during the breaks. I like that.
He does talk.
Well, you know what I do is I get the whole recording, and then, you know, I talk to him, and Donna tells him, I got him on tape saying, now it's recorded during the break. And we always let that. And then I go, okay, now what we need to talk about and they reveal so much crap during the breaks. That's where the real show is, when everybody goes to the archive.
Well, Ernie and I have been friends for 20 years. So that's why that.
So Ernie's the Liberty NSA
stuff.
NSA needs to
know. Ernie, are you an NSA plant? Are you a confidential informant?
As far as you know.
They don't need to have plants because we're all bugging our own houses at this point.
You know, we should also assume, Michael, is that everything that we say on the radio broadcast is a postcard to the NSA.
I assume everything I say in my home when there's no microphones on is being listened to. And, you know,
I used to
say you were crazy to say that kind of stuff, but then Edward Snowden happened.
Well, there's they always ask me, they say, do you think you're being recorded? I go, well, I always assume I am. They have to change the agents every 2 weeks because we keep converting them.
Now, what you have to think about is that the fact of the matter is that Ernie and Boston and myself, and I would be presumptuous enough to say that Michael thinks that the ownership of other human beings is wrong. And that being the case, the message is the media.
Yeah.
Yep. But they don't even feel like they own you. It's like they influence.
Well, they think they can manipulate us, but little do they know that we know that we are in control of our own destinies.
Yeah. So we never really finished on, we're waiting for Boston to get back. Bill, what is your thought on the whole Colbert thing? And I'm not trying to get you on record like, oh, those people are bad, because I don't really think it's bad that they did that. And I knew it would look like that. And I thought it was hilarious. And I'm a fan of Colbert. I really didn't like the unsafe gun handling. But what do you think in general of that whole thing?
You know, I think Oliver, I think Stewart, and all the rest of them, whether they are unwitting or witting, collectivist collaborators, as it were, they really do, every time they broadcast, expose what the broadcast is, what the mainstream media is about.
Oliver especially, his new show is great, man.
It's just brilliant. He really hits at the nugget of why the state manipulation of the media and, you know, people in general is basically just a farce. And why, in the end, if we think critically enough, we will discover that we are being manipulated. Ernie?
As much as they are a lot of the things that I don't agree with on net, they are so freaking awesome.
John Stewart's awesome.
I have used so Oliver's many of awesome. His clips.
My favorites in order are Oliver, then Stewart, then Colbert.
I'm with you.
Yeah.
You know, this is, you know, one thing about the Colbert piece is I saw Ian Freeman, you know, sitting there in the beginning of it.
They didn't put him on because he sounded too smart.
Exactly.
I'm sure. I know he was interviewed and he sounded too smart.
That he did not feed into whatever the hell it was, and they didn't want a single freaking syllable from him, and they had to go to Chris.
You know, he and you, Free Talk Live guys, Ian and Mark, and you, Ernie, are two of the few named libertarians I can't say anything bad about. And I can say bad things about you is that I can't get a word in edgewise a lot, but I have the mute button now, and I really like this. So
I can't say as a co-host of Michael Freedom Fiends, and I know that sounds a bit inebriated, but nonetheless, as a co-host of the Michael Dean's Freedom Fiends, I can say for the most part, every minute that they broadcast is something that they can proudly record and say, yay and verily, this is why slavery doesn't work.
Yeah. Yeah, and Free Talk Live takes a lot of calls from idiots, and that's usually when I turn it off. But, you know, it serves a purpose. Because, you know, the idiots can say who would build the roads and they can tell them who'd build them. And I just don't want to talk to idiots. That's why I don't take calls. But we'll be back on the Freedom Fiends.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends, and I'm beaming these words into your cerebellum. The central scrutinizer is a Soviet-style Leviathan trying to keep track of all you do. That's why I use a VPN, or virtual private network, from Bola VPN. Bola VPN is inexpensive, secure, and will allow you to use your computer without leaving a trail. Bola VPN is now also offering torrent seed boxes for safely sharing media with the world. And if you open a support ticket saying you heard about them from the Freedom Fiends, they'll add 3 extra days free. That's Bola VPN at BOLEHVPN.net.
Now that the elections are over and liberty has slipped even further away, it's time to try yet another political organization. Campaign for a Longer Leash is a nonpartisan group of pups and dogs dedicated to fighting for longer leashes for all. We're not talking about no leashes, that would be catarchy. We just want the limited leash that the Hounding Fathers promised us. As Bone Barklin once said, a longer leash if you can keep it, ma'am. For more info, go to facebook.com/campaignforalongerleash.
So much truth, it hurts. So we're going to hear a bit from Boston Tea Party right now. I'm sure Ernie will be yelling in the background and waving his arms. But Boston is not on radio much, so I want to get a little...
I will push my button and it's off now.
There we go. Thank you. Okay, he'll still be yelling. All right, so Boston and Ernie, I want to know... I mean, Boston and Bill, and especially Boston, I want to know what you think about the Liberty movement, the Liberty mission, where it's gone to... and where you think it's going, and if what you think they could be doing better, or if they're doing it fine, let me know.
Yeah, fair question. When are we back online?
We're on now.
Oh, it's live?
Yeah, we're live.
Oh. Okay. Well, Liberty Mission.
Live. Ernie didn't have his mic on.
Yeah, Ernie's not talking.
Just hit him over the head with something. It's not a violation of the non-aggression principle. It's doing him a favor.
Yeah, it's the next best thing.
Have another drink.
It's one of those asterisks to the non-aggression principle. You can hit it. You can hit Ernie over the head when it's nap time and he needs some rest.
Look, Ernie's been in this in his extent since the late 80s, which is very cool. I didn't know that. I've been in this as a publisher and an author since the early 90s. You know, before the internet, you know, back when my book came out, I mean, this was Clinton versus Bo Greitz, you know, who was like the weirdo, you know, alternative candidate, who rated nothing, but you know, he boosted the radar a bit. You know, this is a long time ago.
Isn't that the guy they sent in to try to negotiate at Ruby Ridge?
They did that, and that's actually a fact. And he probably
He volunteered, actually. Yeah,
he did. He said, "Look, you know, this is you know, Randy Weaver is a special forces guy. He wasn't necessarily under my command, but you know, he's SF, and you know, he can't be that much of a bad guy like you're saying. So let me talk to him." And he did, that after his son, you know, had his arm blown away and died at the scene. And I think this was after his wife had been shot in the jaw by FBO sniper Lon Horiuchi. May his name live forever in infamy. So, yeah, Bo Greitz, you know, was like key into presidential politics back in '92. Well, very cool. So this is, you know, my book and, you know, my shtick goes back a bit of a ways, you know, 22 years ago. I shudder to think. So it's weird to feel like, you know, sort of the, you know, junior grandpa for the freedom movement. But I mean, look at people who are older than me. They're either, you know, deceased or decrepit. So, you know, who's left but me and, you know,
Claire Wolfe.
Claire and I are as far as age-wise, about contemporary. She's a little more mature chronologically than I am, but, you know, not much, and I don't know what she's doing.
And a lot lately. Of other ways. She's got experience. Claire, I got a lot of respect for Claire, and yeah, you too.
Claire's a cool hippie, you know, kind of thing.
A hippie grandma with a gun.
That's fair. I don't think Claire would object to that, so, yeah. So anyway, you know, things move on, times change, and you know, you look around, you know, shoulder to shoulder, and it's like, okay, I guess I'm the grandpa, you know, of you know, certain aspects of this thing. It's like, okay, you know, I paid my dues. I've written 14 books, 8 of which are still in title because of not being.
And you get to write books like Modules for Manhood.
It's a good book, and we're going to interview you about when the second one comes out. There's a lot of of these young pups in Liberty now don't know who you are, but that's because you're not on the internet and you're not on Facebook and you're not in their face and you rarely give an appearance. But I think that your influence is vastly felt. I mean, I think Larken took a lot from you. I know the Cop Block guys. You know, their whole thing is basically based on your book, You and the Police. I've never heard him say it, but I can tell.
I so hope so, because You and the Police is solid, solid, solid.
That's the book that took me to liberty in one sitting. It took me from statist to minarchist in one night. Here's what happened. I bought guns. My wife and I bought guns when someone tried to break into our house in California while I was home. We bought a shotgun. And I bought a book on Amazon about shotgunnery. It actually turned out to be about turkey hunting. It wasn't very useful for home defense.
Not quite what you wanted.
But I bought it, and it said, people who bought this book also bought, and one of them was You and the Police. And I was like, what's that? And it was, you know, it was a little paperback. It didn't have a lot of pages. I was like, I could read that. And I got it, and I read it in one sitting. And I didn't know that open carry was a thing, legal open carry.
No idea this was a concept, right?
Yeah, and I was in California, and we'd bought handguns by that point and really wanted to be able to take them out of the house, and it was impossible to do it legally. And I was like, what, open carry?
I can rent?
Yeah, and I looked it up, read about it on Wikipedia, and at the end of your book, it said... it had a link to the Free State Wyoming thing. And, I went on the site and it was like, it was like 4 a.m. You know, I'd started reading this book at like 6 PM. I finished it at midnight and then was poking around on the internet. And about 4 a.m, I got on the Free State Wyoming, forum and I posted, "Hi, my wife and I live in California. We have guns and are intrigued and wish to subscribe to your newsletter. Mama Liberty, who gets up at 5 a.m. Wyoming time, 4 a.m. California time, said," the only person on the forum at the time said, "Welcome, I'm Mama Liberty." I started chatting with her. And 2 hours later, I woke my wife up 15 minutes before she had to get up and go to work and said, "Honey, we're moving to Wyoming."
Well, where's that? Right.
Yeah, that's what happened, man. It was that book.
And you did. You bless you both.
Yeah, because a lot of people pledge, many pledge and few go.
Yeah. No, I've you know, to the listeners out there, I've enjoyed the hospitality of you two. I think twice, right? I've been out there twice.
Yeah,
and it's like, you know, the most humbling thing is to, you know, think of a paradigm where, you know, wherever you are, you come move to the state that I think that you should move to for, you know, XYZ reasons.
Yeah.
And, you know, whether it was a website or a novel, and, you know, people read this. I remember the first time someone, I read your novel and I've just moved here and, you know, I'm looking for new friends and I love it and blah, blah. And it's like, really? I've got strangers moving to a I said, you know, was really cool and you should go to because I said so and all that. And you were one of the very early adopters.
You know, it's like, one thing when you influence people like this, it's not it's how weird. Many, it's who. It's the quality.
Yeah.
The fact that it happens at all. And then you meet the quality.
No, it's the quality of the people. I'm telling
but that
you.
Comes later.
Nah, everybody's always like, well, how many people? I don't give crap how many. It's the quality of the people.
Well, at first, you know, there is no quantity, right? Because it's
there's
just
Michael
like,
W. Dean.
Yeah, but at first, Michael W. Dean was one of the first. I mean, when did you move out? 05?
Five. We've been here 5 years now. No, you're thinking we were earlier than we were. It was 2000. It was 2009. May of 2009.
You have the gravitas.
But we did it quick. And it was like, we did it quick. And we had a house to sell. It wasn't like throw some stuff in the back of the car and drive. It was like. And
we had those folks also. But I mean, you know, 09, you're saying 09, you moved out?
Yeah.
You know, Bill Buford's
not. That's pretty early.
Buford's not here, but he has a new consulting thing that he's doing. He's getting gigs speaking on leadership and so on called Gravitas Group or whatever his Gravitas thing. His wife, Lilo, he's not allowed to talk anymore. He's been drinking, you know, and so have we.
Tonight he's not allowed to talk tonight?
You got somebody to protect
him. He'll come back.
Okay. He'll come back. Yeah, get back here, Bill.
Right.
And they're not really drinking. Well, you're not allowed to drink on the air, and they're drinking fake martinis like they do on movies. Yeah.
You can drink before the air.
Yeah.
Because who would know, right?
Yeah. So Boston, I mean, it's kind of hard to ask Boston, what do you think of where the Liberty Movement's at? Because you don't go on the Facebooks, which is kind of where the Liberty Movement's at. But from what you can see of it, what do you think is being done right or wrong?
Well, I mean, it's easy to ask me this because, you know, my opinion is important to someone else's opinion. So it's not like
I want to know what it is.
Yeah, right. Ernie wants to know. Right. I just don't volunteer it egregiously amongst the media. So maybe that's the only. I have an opinion like anyone else.
You don't have to give it. I don't want to put you on the spot.
No. I'm happy to give it. Okay. I just
what
don't.
Is it?
Yeah, he doesn't consider you media.
No, I don't.
You're activist kind of truth. That's a difference.
That's actually fair. You know, Michael, I've known for, you know, more than 5 years. He's been with the Free State Wyoming Project. So, no, when I talk to Michael, it's not like I'm talking to, you know, Ted Koppel and I have to, like, you know, pull my punches and all that. The freedom movement has been interesting in the 22 years in which I've been personally immersed within it. What's different, you know, I can't comment quickly on the past 22 years, but I can say something about the past 10 years, right?
Yeah.
What's different about that in the past 10 years, it's gotten, and I think it's a good thing, it's gotten more individually, tactically oriented. And if you talk about things in a military sense from strategic versus tactically, strategic is beta, meta, you know, big sense, big picture kind of thing. And there's nothing wrong with that. I think the libertarian movement started out with a you know, big picture kind of thing when it should have started out with a smaller, medium picture kind of thing. And that's what we've resolved ourselves to. And I think that's what's been more successful.
Yeah.
And that's what started Free State Wyoming is because, you know, we've given up on taking over, you know, the whole country through, you know, libertarian activism and, you know, libertarian politics. And, you know, we're not going to outpace the Republican Party or the Democratic Party. That's just fantasy. But what can we do? What do we have with the numbers that we own and the philosophy that we can project energetically, and it could be quite a lot. So that's why
communities.
Exactly. Right. I backtrack to, you know, tactical sense of communities, counties, and even states. States would be, you know, the ultimate wet dream of our energy and possibilities. And the Free State Project is a parallel development back in 03 with Jason Sorens. He figured this out the same way. I had a different kind of tack to it, and I still do. But, you know, let's get to the basics. And my book, Modules for Manhood, you know, ironically squinches that down. It resolves it down to not just communities or the particular states, but like, who are you as?
Yeah, you know? Secession, secession to the last man.
To you the know, last man. Claire, right. Wolfe, and Mark.
Listening to Freedom Feens with Michael Dean and some of his weird friends. And yes, we're broadcasting this into space.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Feens Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfeens.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Feens will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
Hey, this is Nathan Explosion from Death Clock, and you're listening to Freedom Feens on the radio. Worms.
How does he turn his mic off? Right.
Freedom Feens, turning down Ernie Hancock's mic since 2011. Yep, all right. So, last segment is all Boston all the time. It's 5 minutes, Boston Tea Party, also known as Kenneth Royce, founder of the Free State Wyoming and author of a bunch of books that I'm going to link in the show notes on the Freedom Fiends site. You can go find that. So, Boston, you're talking about liberty, past, present, and future. Your thoughts, Ernie. Please. Ernie, sorry, Boston. Not yeah. Ernie.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, see, like Ernie just talks so much that I think, like, when I meet, go to say Boston, I say Ernie. So go ahead.
Yeah, when I drink water, he doesn't speak. It's that kind of, you know, anything. All right, so we got a hot mic. Past, present, and future of liberty. Wow, gee. I mean, you know, what have we got? 22 years of, like, encapsulation here?
Yeah, okay. I mean, from where it depends where you want to start it, but, you know, of the modern version of libertarianism, I'd say about that, yeah.
Wow. I mean, it's a lot to compress. I mean, I started in the Clinton regime. I mean...
And it really felt like that was going to be the end of the world at that point.
You know, back then, it seemed pretty prescient. It seemed pretty, high-end, energetic, and so forth. You know, in 92, we had the end of George Bush. It's like a transfer of the guard. And, you know, who's next? Is it George Bush 2? Is it, someone else? And, you know, Bo Greitz was the independent candidate. And, you know, he had a lot of cred. You know, there's a lot of energy going on, you know, back then. My book started, as far as my writing part of it, started in 89 with real energy from 91 until the presidential candidacy in November 92. So it's like, This is like ancient history. It's like You asked me about the Civil War. I mean, it feels that old. It feels
how
that.
How about this? How about this? How's liberty work in a daily basis on your life today?
Well, that feels very current. That feels very yesterday. I mean, how can I talk about what happened yesterday? You're asking me to wrap my arms around, you know, something I've had a career with for 22 years as far as, you know, strategically.
All right. What'd you do today? 2 minutes.
Okay. What I did today. Tactically speaking, I flew a single engine fixed wing airplane from California to Phoenix area.
Cool.
That's what I did today. I stopped in to lunch in Palm Springs had lunch with a guy in a business sense who's a business partner with a friend of mine. And, you know, we got to like, you know, meet, greet, retreat. So I did that. Then flew out and Ernie picked me up. So, I mean, you know, that's a cool thing in a way, not to like brag about, you know, I flew from the West Coast to Phoenix and all that. However, what's cool about all this is like, well, okay, if you got something going on, why wouldn't you fly from the West Coast to Phoenix or whatever?
Did you fly to Libertopia?
I did. Yeah.
Cool, man. I think that's liberty in action, because a lot of liberty stuff is theoretical. It's on the. It's when the government's out of our way, here's what we'll do.
Yeah, right.
But you do what you can do in the meantime, man.
I've been in the airplane for a month. I've slept in the airplane. I've had food in the airplane. I've been in this airplane for a month. So it's like, where am I? Well, okay, my GPS says I'm here and all that. And it is. I mean, being a pilot, and I spoke of this at Libertopia as sort of an adjunct kind of thing, not to like trumpet my pilot horn, but you can't help it. You know, once you start to fly...
Yeah.
You just can't help it.
Not many people do it.
Or should you?
How long have you been doing it?
I've flown for many years, but the past couple of years, I've flown hard marge, you know, to use the line.
Is this your first plane that you have, or have you had planes before?
It's something I'm a partner with. I mean, you know, if I can reserve, you know, as far as, you know, what I do and how I do it.
Yeah,
you know,
blah,
blah, blah, blah, blah.
Well, cool.
So, yeah, this is the first plane I've had a significant relationship with, whatever that means.
And you know, that's what liberty leads to, is man-on-plane marriages. Thanks, Boston. And tell your compatriots, thank you for their service on the Freedom Feens. Worms. Worms.